Viewers, good morning and welcome to this week's episode of The Mirror. I am still your favorite host, Beauty Benjamin. And this morning we have with us again our Dr. Josiah. If you've been following up this The Mirror, you must have watched him before. He's like our family doctor now, and he'll be treating and taking care of The Mirror. So today he's here again, and today we'll be talking on the topic medical brain drain. I don't know what that means, but he's here and he'll tell us. Doctor, you're welcome back to The Mirror.
Thank you.
It's good to have you back.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you. Happy Easter.
Same to you.
Now, Doctor, this medical brain drain, what is it all about?
Yes, thank you. Medical brain drain is the fact that there are a lot of doctors, medical personnel, doctors, nurses, physiotherapists, radiographers, and all the lab scientists who migrate from one country to another country, leaving the services that they're supposed to render to their motherland to another place. That's what brain drain is about. So you talk about it in the academia, and when our lecturers are going to some other countries to practice being lecturers, the same thing that is happening in the medical field is even worse in the medical field than in the academia.
Yes. So now, what is responsible? Why are people leaving the motherland where they're supposed to feed the people and then going outside?
It boils down to the same thing that makes people migrate naturally from Nigeria. You hear about the trans-Saharan migration, where Nigerians, some of them are very productive people, and they sell their property and migrate. They pass through the Sahara Desert to Libya on their way to Europe or another part of this world. It's the same thing, better condition of service, better opportunities to succeed, because naturally our own country Nigeria is not, or an Africa in general, we do not invest adequately into the healthcare. We don't put enough money into the healthcare sector, so that you go and train, let's say you go and train abroad now, and you become a specialist, maybe neurosurgeon, or there are some specialties that are very rare. And then you come back with the promise that when you come, they're going to give you employment. And you come, and there's no job to do. What do? You know that you are wasting your time. You're a neurosurgeon, you are working in a government hospital, like the teaching hospitals, and then you don't have the necessary equipment to work with. So you'll be wasting time. You will just be there still referring patients to your colleagues or even your junior colleagues who are somewhere where they have the equipment. So that is one issue. Then the other issue is that people like the federal government of Nigeria allocates 4% of its resources, of its budget. That is the capital budget is allocated to healthcare. Just 4%.
Only.
While, yes, it's supposed to allocate up to 20-25% to the healthcare sector. But they are not doing that. When they don't do that, the hospitals, you just go. Most people go to the hospital and they come back complaining that this one is not available, there is no light, there is no this, there is no...
Always.
That. So always people come back with such complaints. And then the hospital that originally was built to be a 500-bedded hospital now receives patients and they need to admit up to 800. And then there is no expansion. And then when you go, you blame the doctors for not creating space for you. When you go and they turn you back, they tell you there is no space to admit. You think that they are doing it deliberately. But the truth is that they have exceeded their capacity. For you, there's a number of the complements of doctor to nurses and to the patient that are supposed to be in a particular hospital. So if you say it's a 500-bedded hospital, you should have certain number of beds, certain number of doctors and nurses and lab scientists and all that.
All available.
Available to attend. So you don't just say, okay, we'll build space for you now, since you are looking for space. When you build that space, you have to employ.
Yes.
So when we don't have that available, it's difficult for people to you become underemployed, or you're even employed and you are not well paid. You are not well paid. In Nigeria, many people believe that the doctor is very well paid.
But are they not?
When you now compare the salary of the doctor to that of the doctor in another country, that is in dollars.
But we can't do that. We can't compare.
So, meanwhile, countries from outside come here to advertise. They know the worth of our doctors.
Mm.
Recently, Saudi Arabia sent some consultants to come to Nigeria to recruit doctors and take to Saudi Arabia. The Nigerian government is watching them. They didn't do anything about them. Another country also sent people to come and recruit doctors. And before you know, all they needed was about 100 to 200 doctors. But the number of doctors that attended the interview was about 6,000.
Jeez.
Because everybody wants to migrate. Leave. We are talking about that we don't have enough specialists in Nigeria. There are a lot of my colleagues who have finished their residency training, they are consultants, and they don't have a place to be employed in River State here. So they don't have a choice. Some of them are River State born. That is, it's not like they are just living in River State. They are indigents of River State, and they don't have a job. They are not employed. And so what do? You can't just stay there and be hungry. So the next option is to look for the next available. United Kingdom is looking for doctors every day from Nigeria.
And they're paying so well.
And they are paying you so well compared, and the education of your children is free. You have a lot of insurance covering you and all that. It's not here when you do a little thing, they can want to arrest you and all that, and nobody even cares what happens to you. Everybody will blame the doctor for anything that happens. But there's an insurance cover on your practice. So when you look at the cost of the amount they pay you here and what they are willing to offer you for the same qualification, of course everybody wants to migrate there. But most annoyingly, our minister, the present minister of health, says that we are producing too many doctors than we can employ. And so some of them should become tailors, some of them should be going to other businesses, and that we cannot absorb everyone.
That is sad to hear. But look at it from this way now. It's like I'm trying to... The ones that the government sponsor, like the ones they send on scholarship, you know, and then they go and come back, and you still want to leave. I mean, it still boils down to the same thing.
It still boils down to the fact that when you are sending people to travel abroad, you want to train them. Hardly do you see those who are trained that want to still travel out if they are employed. The terms of agreement when you are sending this person to be trained abroad, what was their term?
Okay.
Did you write that when you come back, you will be employed. Automatically? As they came back, did the government fulfill its own side of the obligation by employing them automatically?
Yeah.
If the government did not fulfill that side of the agreement of employing them automatically, then the other side of the agreement cannot hold, where the person cannot travel out of this country.
Okay.
So if government has sent out 100 persons to train abroad and they finish and come, what I know that is automatic is the house job. You come and do your housemanship for 1 year. After that, they go to do youth service and then they come back. Employment is not automatic.
Part of it.
So if full-time employment is not automatic, and then, of course, the person cannot just sit down and waiting for you forever. Because in the first place, the government has failed in its obligation in employing them automatically. Mm. Because that is what it's supposed to be. That we are going to train you, and when you come back, automatically you are a staff of any state government that sent them out. And when you come back, you finish, you are employed, you are given everything, the conditions to work.
To work.
And you are given that you cannot leave the services of the state government for 5 to 10 years, depending on the agreement the government has with you. And every doctor, every reasonable doctor will adhere to that. But if you break it as a doctor, the government has the right to take you to court and stop you from being employed in any part of this country, so long as you have that agreement.
Okay. Now, you said something about doctors migrating or countries looking for doctors from Nigeria. Now let's look at it from the practice. Now, Saudi Arabia coming in to employ doctors, is it that our doctors are more trained or qualified or what? Because everybody tends to, I want to study abroad. Abroad. Then now you have the abroad coming to take from here.
No. In every training, there is a curriculum.
Okay.
So every country that wants to get engage a doctor goes with the curriculum, looks at the curriculum of your training.
Okay.
How well trained and prepared are you?
Mm.
So when they look at our curriculum and see the rigors we go through, they know that our certificate is acceptable
anywhere
and in those places. So they go. There are some countries that make it that you must write certain qualifying exams.
Okay.
And our people go there and they pass that exam just stresslessly. That gives you an information that our people, our training is too rigorous because the detail of our training is too much. We do mechanical. We don't have all those aids that the Oyibo people use to train their own people that makes life easy for them.
Mm.
How you do it, you sweat before you can graduate. So in it's those countries practical. Like Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Dubai, and all that, they have evaluated our curriculum and have certified that anybody that graduated from a Nigerian university that is acceptable by NUC is also acceptable to practice in their country.
Thank you, viewer. We are still on the mirror this morning. We'll be going on a quick break and we'll come back. The doctor is still with us. Don't go away. Viewers, welcome back to the show. We're back from the breakfast table. And if you're just joining us, this is The Mirror with Beauty Benjamin. We've been talking to a pediatrician consultant in the River State University Teaching Hospital, Dr. Josiah Apollos. And the topic today is medical brain drain. Just grab your cup of coffee. It's not too late to drink your coffee while we rule. Doctor, welcome back.
Thank you so much.
This brain drain thing is, I'm beginning to wonder whether in our own profession, don't we have brain drain so that we could also migrate?
No.
I mean,
in your media.
Yes.
Of course, there are Nigerians that are migrating out of this country.
But there seem to be, a lot, I mean, it's so lucrative. I mean, the offer, they are so, wow. It sounds good.
Yes.
But let's come back home now. I don't know. Is there no solution to this issue? Because if we have all our experts or our specialists leaving, migrating, what's the hope of the people?
It all depends on the country. It depends on the government of the day. If the government wants Nigerian specialists, the doctors, the nurses, and the other paramedical staff to remain in this country, they will. They can do something about it. Like I talked about that the funding of medical practice or the health sector is very poor. Even making, encouraging the private sector to come into the sector is also very poor.
Mm.
In India, today people are talking about going to India. The government of India deliberately, all the hospitals that people go to, almost all the hospitals that people go to India to receive care, they are all private hospitals, but they're called group practice.
Okay.
Several specialists will come together and set up a very big hospital.
Okay.
But what government did, the government of India did, was to give them huge loans to build the hospital and equip it and pay over a very long time. Pay like use 30 years to pay the loan, 20 years to pay the loan, and at a very low interest rate. The idea that government has about is that when we give out this loan, these people will build big hospitals and medical tourism will bring in a lot of patients.
Mm.
Like we go there for medical tourism, we go there for treatment. As you are going, it is not only the person that is to receive treatment. You go with an attendant, probably you go with a doctor, and then when they come there, they will patronize their hotels, they will patronize their transportation, and dollars will be sent into the economy.
Mm.
So that now gives strength to
to their rupees, and their economy is better. That is how the government will profit in the long run in the business. And then the hospitals also pay tax to government, because the tax that goes in there is not hidden. So government can easily identify those taxes and pay, ask them to pay taxes, and they will make money. So it was a long-term plan, and it is yielding good results today in India. We can as well do the same thing. If the government decides to give doctors loans to set up hospitals and run, it's not like the one that some state government may give, and it is just maybe pay over 5 years, and the interest rate is like 20-something percent. Mm. Even if government decide to even pay the interest rate, the fact is that you ask somebody to start to... The monies are not even given for you to build the hospital. It's just to buy equipment.
Okay.
But these hospitals are not even built on a big expanse of land. You just buy equipment alone. Meanwhile, the physical structure is nothing to write home about, and people don't want to attend such a hospital.
Yes.
So there must be a deliberate plan by government on a long-term and a short-term basis to encourage private practice. So that is one way. If the private practice is encouraged... Two, if government provides money for research findings, people do studies. They study and make researches in how to improve their practice. And government makes money available in those developed countries. But in Nigeria, money is not made available for you to do any research. If you want to do any research, no matter how fabulous it is to the healthcare, you have to fund it by yourself. There is no funds anywhere that you can access and apply and say, okay, even if you want to go for an update course that will improve your practice, you can't even depend on the government agency to fund it for you. You have to fund it by yourself. So government must make deliberate efforts. And then there is no how the economy of a country, that is the health sector, will improve if the general economy is not improved.
At all.
Because the doctor earns a salary and spends it within this country, and the money does not have any value. They pay you the salary, the little salary they pay you here, and the inflation rate is going up and up. So at the end of the day, you see that, oh, they say you are earning big money, and then at the end of the day, you are not able to achieve anything with it. But the economy of those developed countries, you go to UK, US, and all that, the economy is stable. So that even if they increase their salary, the prices of things doesn't just take it out.
Mm.
So you look at yourself, that, okay, if I go to UK and they pay me £5,000 per month, if they take their tax and I pay like £1,000+ pounds per month, and what is remaining is maybe £3,500 that is remaining for me to use. By the time you translate that to Naira, you know what it means.
Yeah.
Your children have free education. Your family can grow up and go to the best schools available. You have security and all that. Of course, it encourages you. You want to stay there. But in Nigeria, those of us who decide to stay in Nigeria, I don't know, people have different reasons why they want to stay back in Nigeria and practice.
Mm.
But there are those who have hope that one day it will change. There are those who are genuinely patriotic, thinking that, look, if I don't stay here to help my people, who will
stay? Yeah.
So they stay back because they just want to help their people. So the government must take deliberate effort to work on the economy and improve the economy and improve the welfare of the healthcare worker, so that... That is the package, the take-home package should be improved so that the doctor will be willing to stay and back. And then the insurance that they provide. If healthcare insurance is provided for every citizen, you see that the patronage will improve. If the patronage of the hospitals improve, then the doctor, there will be more money in the health sector to use. And so many people want to stay back and do their practice.
Now, this thing we're talking about here now, the doctors, the private practice or practitioners, has anybody come up with any idea? Say, look, let us come together and put up a writing or an information or something to the government, because you have this information. Government may not know about them, but it's your field. You know about them. I said, look, we are the one doing this. We are the one who know, the people who know how far. This is the way we can help, or we can go further. Has there been any plan? Like, I said, let's come together and put up a writing to the government. I said, look, can we try this?
There has been a lot of stakeholders engagements on every front, the ones initiated by the government, the one initiated by Nigerian Medical Association and other professional bodies in the healthcare sector in Nigeria, trying to do that. They've discussed and given report to government and made several recommendations. The climax of it was in 2014 when President Goodluck Jonathan, after a lot of deliberations with the stakeholders, signed the healthcare bill, the national healthcare bill, that stipulates a setting apart an amount of money, a fund that will fund researches, fund healthcare provision in this country, so that people can, the practitioners can access funds to
but
do what
that,
they want to do.
Is that still going on now?
It's not being implemented. The law has been signed, the bill has been signed into law by President Goodluck Jonathan in 2014. That law is not being implemented. If that law is implemented, at least let us start. If there are issues with it, we resolve it later through amendments. But for at least let that bill come into effect. It provides for the healthcare of people. Certain amount of money is set aside from the consolidated revenue to address health issues. If that is implemented, that will go a long way in resolving the issues that we are talking about, brain drain in Nigeria. But the government doesn't care. The government at the center doesn't care. If the minister will say that, we have too many doctors in Nigeria, so some should go and do tailoring, some should go and set up other businesses to do, and all that. So we are just telling people, look, we are helpless, we can't help you, anything you want to do, just do. Because we are graduating too many doctors.
And that's a detriment
to all the
people.
According to WHO, every doctor is supposed to attend to maybe like one ratio of doctor to patient is
patient.
Small. But now we have like 30,000, one doctor to like 30,000 persons, 40,000 persons, only one doctor. That is, if you take the ratio, the population of doctors to the patients in the society is so much. So even though we are producing a lot of doctors, the ratio is still grossly inadequate. But our government is saying that doctors are already too many that they cannot employ. And they are not encouraging the private sector to create employment in that sector. That is where we are.
Okay, now let's look at countries like UK.
Yes.
Now, them coming here now, getting doctors to UK, their doctors migrating. What's the reason?
Our doctors migrating to UK?
No. Yes, ours going to UK, yes. And then doctors in UK migrating out of UK.
No, doctors in UK are not migrating to Nigeria. No.
Not Nigeria, other countries.
No, they are not migrating. I'm not
aware
that they are migrating.
Are they running out?
They are planning. They have a plan that, okay, by the time our population is up to this, this is the number of doctors that we should have.
Okay.
This is the number of lab scientists we should have according to that ratio. They are trying at every point in time to keep up with that ratio.
Planning for tomorrow.
So that is why once there is a disparity in the ratio, they open doors for more doctors to come in. And our people are ready, people to just go in and fill in the space. So it's not like their doctors are migrating. They have doctors, but some of them are retiring. And then looking at their population growth, they want to keep up with the ratio so that the doctors are not overworked. But in Nigeria, the doctors are overworked and they're still paid peanuts.
As usual, in this show, time is not our friend. At the time we are getting to it, the time is short. Doctor, what's your advice to the government, to doctors like you, patriotic ones, and to everybody?
My advice is that government at the center should try and implement the healthcare bill, the national healthcare bill that was signed into law in 2014. If there are issues with it, they can address it later, but let them put it into practice. Okay. The government at the state level and the national level should look at funding the healthcare much more than they are doing. And if there are doctors that were trained with hard-end resources of the states, as soon as they come, they should give them automatic employment. It's not waiting for when government wants to employ. It should be an automatic thing. Okay. And then the private sector should be encouraged with interest-free loans or a loan that will take long years to recover, you know, so that they can develop the private sector, because government alone cannot solve this problem. So the private sector should be encouraged to come in and salvage our economy. We will stay back.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Josiah. It was good having you on the show here. As usual, he's a family doctor on this, the Mirror. Every time, you will always be here to talk to us. So if you have questions for him, if you have whatever for him, you can always reach Dr. Josiah through the Mirror. Thank you so much. You can watch this episode on YouTube, like our page on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, just the Mirror with Beauty Benjamin. For your sponsorship, partnership, and contributions, just send an SMS to the number or WhatsApp to the number scrolling on your screen. Thank you. I am Beauty Benjamin. Same time, same session next week.